Welcome back to the Complete Guide to Horror podcast. Today, Coop, BP and I are discussing the fantastically over-the-top and brutal fan favourite of the franchise, Final Destination 3, which was released in 2006. Now, personally, I do have a secret to confess and it's kind of embarrassing. So I've only watched this movie in full twice. I tried re-watching it in full for this podcast episode, but I'm still genuinely disturbed by that fucking tanning bed scene, so I skipped that part. It's something that I've actually spoken about in therapy. Now, most people who have me on Facebook or Instagram know that I have weird phobias and triggers, which I talk about all the time. So, for instance, if I watch a trailer or see a poster for a disaster movie like Geostorm, Deep Impact, that has a tsunami, I go into genuine panic attacks where I can't breathe. I feel like I lose my motor skills. My therapist explained that because I've had traumatic experiences with almost drowning, being burned by boiling water, etc., my subconscious automatically enables a fight or flight state, which I think is why I've cheated death too many times. Regardless, the tanning bed sequence, though, in full, it's fucking amazing and a very cleverly designed death scene. But my gripe is that all of the promos, trailers, posters, even the YouTube thumbnails, etc., for this movie tend to feature the final shots of Ashley and Ashlyn barbecued, as opposed to the build-up, which is not only far less traumatic, but it is a masterclass in editing. When it goes from like temperature to the actual lights in the tanning beds, it's amazing. Now, we were talking in our previous episode about trailers. I watched the US trailer for this movie first, and it shows little bits of each death scene, but the Australian trailer, holy shit. I don't know who put that together, but it was shit. It just has shots of the three main characters and it says, bad things come in threes. Final Destination 3. And I was right. Like, what the fuck is this? They didn't show anything about the movie. There was no roller coaster. There was no death scenes. God. It had a shot of the gym part where the guy gets the weights crushed. But What is it with Australians and not knowing how to do trailers? Because I don't even remember seeing a trailer for Final Destination 2.
That trailer for Final Destination 3, would you think if someone hadn't seen that film and they watched that trailer, it would be enticing enough to want to watch it compared to the US one?
Hell no.
No. Because, you know, sometimes it is good. Sometimes, like, less is more, especially with horror trailers. And in these sort of things, you don't always want to see everything revealed in a trailer.
Yeah.
I don't think I've actually seen a Final Destination trailer because I think I'd sort of heard about them, like, word of mouth. And by the time I'd seen one, like, if I'd heard one was coming out or whatever, that was like, oh, yeah, I'll watch that, you know. Like, it's Final Destination. I'm going to see someone die in a funny way. But, yeah, I can't think of a trailer or sort of think of how it was marketed. It's interesting.
I think Final Destination 3 is the ultimate how to do a sequel correctly, how to do new ideas, new technology. It has the most creative kills. Mm-hmm. I think it also has that rewatchable quality that some of the others just don't necessarily have. Like, I feel like it's a very shortened version of every other Final Destination. There's no bloated sequences around, you're next, or no, I'm not going to die. Or like it just happens one after the other very quick.
Yep.
It's way ahead of you there. There was heaps of new ideas in it, but at the same time, it didn't try and change the whole game as well. Like they tried to do with the second one, like new life and all that shit that they tried to bleed all that into it. That there's like new rules and all this kind of crap. So they like, they kept the formula of the first one, but just sort of tried to get more inventive with the way that it played out. I've probably seen the third one more than any of the others. I've rewatched it a lot of times. It's a fucking good movie. It's fun. Good watchability, that one, for sure.
I think even from like the opening sort of titles, it's sort of, you already got that haunted theme, that sort of circus theme going through. And I tend to warm to that for like a horror movie. And then just like the roller coaster just sets it off, because who doesn't like a roller coaster?
Yeah. So,
yeah.
It's one of those.
I will say though,
and there is something creepy and wonderful about carnivals and
yeah, but it's, you know, it's, kind of it's the mood that movie is quite dark, but in like a circus sort of, you know, fair sort of way. Yeah, I like it.
The roller coaster sequence itself is probably the weakest out of all five openings. Yeah. I don't think that necessarily makes the film bad in any way, because I think it is right for its target audience as well. This one is particularly known for focusing from like college-age students to high school students. So a lot of the actors were pretending to play 17 to 18-year-olds as opposed to 20 to 25, or some characters in the second movie that were in their 30s and 40s. Yeah. I felt that it kept it more cohesive. Didn't necessarily make me afraid of roller coasters. I find so many issues with that sequence in general where, yes, we know that like it was the fluid leaking that caused the seats to fly up and whatnot, but then it's the same thing with like the camera that wraps around and
what did it do? What did the camera do? Click, click,
snap. There's all the pictures on there which are like clues as to how everyone should die and whatnot, but I didn't actually think it was done that well.
The noise of the camera annoyed me. I hated that stupid noise they added in as an effect when she took the photos. Like, I get it's for the movie, but it was just like... and like some cheap Panasonic digital camera. I'm like, wow, going back in time. But yeah.
And she was using a Mac throughout the whole thing. That was horrible.
Wasn't it for a school project? Just getting photos for a school project? Is that what I heard?
Yeah, I think that's so. That's what she kept saying. That's what she but kept what, saying. What,
I don't understand. What like, school what project? People at a theme park or like just at a fair. Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Was it like seniors' day or something? Because she has a go at her little sister because she's a junior or whatever the fuck.
The year sevens are throwing food and stuff, so don't worry, I'll sort it out. I'll get them to clean it up.
All right.
See, miss.
Year sevens,
get up. Go and fucking clean up the milk. And don't throw food around. Yeah. Pick it up. Hurry up.
Oh, my God.
So it's like a seniors thing, and apparently she's got to take pictures for the yearbook, I think. I don't know. I don't know. They always so loosely add this shit through and we're just meant to accept it. So
yeah.
With the opening sequence, I'm a little bit confused. So when the coaster goes up the hill and then, you know, they show that shot of the chain spinning and then it stops. Is that implying that the coaster is then just like in free mode in terms of speed?
That's what I always assumed. I always assume once that breaks and the chains stop, then that, it's just loosely on there. It's just going to go. There's no brakes. It's just on there. But then, that comes back to, well, what does the camera do then when it goes over the camera? What has that done? The bloody pretty boy with the shit haircut gets killed. He's standing up and there's that pole that cuts him in half when it goes backwards. That pole would have had to like go through the seat. And then I'm pretty sure in the next shot, you can still see that seat intact. I don't get it.
Yeah.
So, another little plot hole in that opening bit, but you know.
I'm pretty sure in one of those scenes, I think it's when it starts to break apart and the carriage goes off, and I think it's the girls that go off or the girl and the guy goes off. The sound effect they use, it reminds me of a sound effect, I think maybe in Banjo-Kazooie or Donkey Kong, where you have to sort of slam on one of the buttons on something.
Okay.
Go back and watch it.
Like ground and pound or something.
Yeah, and I'm just like, it's not really like sort of accurate to what the noise would be, metal hitting ground. I don't know.
It's somewhat known that Final Fantasy 3 actually did have plans to use 3D. So all the sequences were created in mind to use some type of 3D effect where it was going to be converted into 3D, like post-production and whatnot. But the studio, I just don't think they necessarily had the budget to do so. So they opted to leave it. There was supposed to be a bit of a different ride as opposed to the roller coaster in the opening sequence, where when the website for Final Destination 3 first opened all the way back in late 2005, there was something called the high dive. All right, you know the giant drop at Dreamworld where it goes all the way up there and just plummets down?
Yeah.
One of the ideas during refilming was to have all these characters on that and then it just would have crashed all the way down. The only problem is, how would you decide who dies one by one? So
how do you make that cinematic as well?
We see it at the start. They're on the ride. The high dive. She takes the photo and it says high die and she's kind of looking at the camera like, oh.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah, because the V is missing.
It wouldn't make sense unless, like, if something hits something and someone ricochets off or a chair goes spinning out. I don't know. It doesn't make sense that you could. Yeah, how would you do that? Who dies first? It makes sense.
Yeah.
Where did you find that? I don't know. The internet.
What things did you both personally hate? BP, we might start with you.
I kind of really hated Wendy as a character. She just annoyed me in the movie. I thought she was just like a soppy bitch. And I didn't find her likable. I just kind of got annoyed by her. I actually really like this movie. I'm with Sean and you as well. I always go back to watch this movie. I think it's a fun movie and I think the kill scenes are really good. My issue with the whole Final Destination film series is I get really annoyed about continuity. And I know it's for a movie, but like, you know, the opening sequence of the roller coaster goes like 10 minutes. And then obviously when it happens, it's only like 30 seconds in and it's already happening. That stuff shits me off, but I know it's for a movie. I don't know. I don't really hate anything about it.
2 hours ago, you were like, let's poison the bitch.
Well, I had a change of heart.
If anything, I didn't really like the scene with the fireworks. For some reason, that scene just kind of annoys me with the horse running off and then the fireworks going off and then her getting impaling by the pole. I just don't really like that whole scene in general. I think they should have just skipped that.
This is sport for me. It's my sport. Listen to me.
But yeah, no, I think it's a good movie. It's like the CGI and it's pretty decent for 2006. And I think it still sort of holds up, especially with the roller coaster side of it.
I'm with Byron on this. I think Final Destination 3 is a really good movie. Kind of agree with what you were saying about Wendy. I feel like that was just, they didn't really develop that character. Like they decided this character is going to be a control freak. And then that's all they thought of. They're just like, oh, well, what's a control freak? Well, they're just apparently just a really annoying individual. And they didn't really do much with the character, which was, yeah, unfortunate. With the opening scenes as well, yeah, they did kind of dive in. And again, that's another thing with character development is like, you don't really get a chance to like, why do I care that they're dying on the roller coaster? Because I've seen fuck all and they seem like douchey people anyway. Like everyone kind of just gets one. And the side, but like sort of the side characters and stuff, you know, you got like the gothy guy and the gothy girlfriend and all that. Mm-hmm. They get like one weird little line, which is like, oh, well, they're like the darker sort of people with the gothic inspirations and shit like that. But otherwise, it's, yeah, really good movie. All the death scenes are really good. It's just some of the script and character development is kind of leaves you wanting more.
I can never remember the character's name, but they're trying to figure out how Wendy, the main character, will die. They're like, look at the photo. Look at the photo. And it's just her and the other guy. And it turns out it's because the other guy is supposed to be the one that kills her. And then bam, like the cherry picker comes down or crane, whatever, splats him. Just felt that they were trying to shoehorn that in too much. That I was just like, I don't care about the mystery of what we're supposed to be looking for in the photo. Because none of the other photos have particularly been that interesting anyway.
Yeah, I looked at some of the photos and I was sort of failing to understand what they were looking at. I'm like, does that mean that? Like the pineapple one? I wouldn't think.
Yeah, was it just because it was really overexposed and red? Because that's what I always got from it. Because I was like, I don't see any fire or like you know anything like that. It's just glare. That's a hint now? I've been on ghost websites that'll tell you that's a ghost because there's glare on the camera. Like,
There's nothing terrifying about that.
And so on that note, actually, I do have more to my answer about what I hate about this movie, and that is where Wendy has found these pictures online, and it's like, well, look at this picture of Abraham Lincoln, and the line on the photo is right where he got hit in the head, and then there's this picture of a plane's shadow on the World Trade Center, and it's just like, you're really reaching now. And the problem with a lot of these movies is a lot of them could more easily explain without sounding crazy, even though of course it is crazy. If these people were better at communicating, then they probably could get more help and assistance from the people around them. But they're like, it's coming to get me, death. It's coming for us all. Can you elaborate? It's coming for us all. It's like, no, I need a bit more than that. Just break it down a little and maybe we can do something. So yeah, that definitely shit me.
If you ask a majority of people that love the series, I'd say like a high proportion would say 3 is definitely up there. I don't know. It's sort of not really hard to hate. I think the death scenes are really good. But like Sean said, and like Justin, it's just like the plot's a bit and the characters a bit And it's that thing you said, Justin, as well. Like you can clearly tell they're probably like 28 or 30. I kind of hate that when they're meant to be in college. Like I just would prefer them to get a younger crop of people that's a bit more believable. Yeah. It's just a bit annoying. Sometimes you can clearly tell they're like 30 and they're like really buff and everything. I'm like, okay, well, they're obviously not 18.
I also didn't realize till I rewatched Final Destination 3 that I don't know if either of you watched Silicon Valley. One of the characters in that is Wendy's younger sister in the movie. But yeah, Silicon Valley is a very good show. So Mike Judge show. Quite good.
Nice.
Quite good.
I have two quotes from that movie I always quote, and it's like show me those titties, and it's like fuck off Frankie, and the other one, which is like hey ho let's go when they're on the roller coaster. That's like two quotes I get from that movie. It's like hey ho let's go. I actually like the character Frankie because I actually find him annoying as fuck, but he's not annoying. It's just like he's an annoying character, but like I'm kind of glad that he dies early, and the girls kind of portray a good sort of bitchy popular group as well. I think those two characters
patting themselves on the back for pitying someone and all that kind of shit. It's like,
but they're good characters. Yeah,
it is like it's like very stereotypical, but like it's still fun because it's just like it's just a horror movie. It's just a bit of fun. Like you just need to very quickly, easily paint a picture that like these are two popular chicks that aren't very nice people. So.
Yeah.
The Frankie death scene was good as well. That lead up to where you just kind of find out once he's dead, it's like, oh, that was him in front of them at the drive through. I thought that was a really good scene.
Yeah, you just get like a top hat and a thing, like the middle finger, and you're just like, who is that person in the convertible?
Yep.
Part of Session 3 is on par with the fifth installment in terms of great cinematography. So there's a lot of really striking visuals, which like immediately invoke fear into my tiny little immature child heart, where I can watch any of these sequences, that's fine. But if I see like a still image from like the tanning bed sequence, I have to like think of something else because it freaks me out, like really freaks me out. But watching the sequence itself, it is so cool and it's so well done how like it is that nice slow build up. There's the Love Roller Coaster song. There's also just some trivia behind that song too, where it was an urban legend that this girl had been painted gold and then like she had died. There was another use of the song where they had poured honey on the singer of the song and then you can hear her recorded screams in the song itself.
I have heard something about that, yeah.
Yeah.
So there was like a murder that took place nearby or something and the screen was just happened to be in the recording. I've heard that.
I've been in a tanning bed in Los Angeles. There is no fucking way that would ever happen. Like, first of all, none of that like actually closes all the way. There's spaces at the end to like pop out. The temperature would never go that high either, which I think it went to 390 Fahrenheit, which I don't know what that is in Celsius, but I'm sure it's like really fucking hot.
Yeah.
But there's some logistical issues with those scenes. But the way that they filmed it, I look at that and I'm like, okay, that's great editing. Like, cuts back to this and it cuts back to that. It's never boring. I find that even though those two particular actresses, I actually think could have ramped it up a bit more, there's other death scenes where you can feel the pain. And it's like, ooh, Jesus, like the nail gun sequence. And she does that little whelp at the end. I'm like, ugh. I don't want to watch this.
Even just the build up with like the blue within the tanning bed, and then as it's getting hotter, and you can see the sweat on their skin and all that kind of shit, and they look real fucked because they're under a blue light. Like they almost already looked fucked up before they're starting to get hurt, and then you've got like the happy music and everything. It's quite unnerving.
It's freaky.
Yeah,
like you've got the sunscreen as well oozing out, and then it cuts back to like the water dew from the slushy.
Yeah,
and then
that's right.
They're kind of like oohing in the tanning bed, and then one of them's like, and you can sort of see that when it turns, like, and
it's coming. Yeah.
I'm actually,
and then the transition from the two tanning beds to the two funerals. That's why are they having a combined funeral? And another thing, and we'll get to this when we get to Final Destination 5. Because apparently group funerals or double funerals or whatever are kind of a thing in these Final Destination movies.
One issue with the tanning bed sequence. So the guy that owns the tanning bed salon, he gets outside and he puts that bottle of shit under to try and stop the door. And he's just like, I'll come help you girls. And then he just stands there. Like, can't he just walk around the front? Can't he just like get in a different way? Like, I look at that, I'm like, I know that they're trying to make it so that it's, oh, no one can help them, blah, blah, blah. But they could have done something else where maybe he, like, tries to get in, he gets electrocuted, or because it would feed into that whole theme with Final Destination Series 2 where they inadvertently affect other characters, which is what they touched on in the second Final Destination. There's so many ways that they could have done it, but that sequence haunts me. And like even talking about it, I get like chills. Like I have to be like, ugh. So I think anyway.
The only bugbear with that scene is it sort of doesn't seem plausible that a plank of wood can sort of fall and then somehow fall into both of them aligned perfectly so they can't get up. Because I mean, technically, I think that wood would fall and probably fall in between or maybe fall in one, but I know it's for a movie,
and then be on the ground on the other side or
something. It wouldn't just kind of like slide into both and then they can't, and I know it's for a movie, but it just annoys me that
and not to mention the fact that the lid part of the tanning bed would be a lot heavier than that plank of wood, so if you were really like if you were in there dying pushing that thing up, I'm sorry, but you would be cracking that wood or moving it in some way. So
it's a good scene though. It's a claustrophobic scene. Reminds me of that movie Buried. I don't know if anyone saw it.
I think it's funny that like we keep going, oh no, I know, I love this movie. Like, yeah, no, this one really stands out, but we're just like picking it to pieces right now. Like every scene is just like, oh no, this, that, but no, I love it. I love it though.
It's a good scene.
I guess it's because we've seen it so often.
Yeah. I think the song sets it because it is a good song. And it's all happy days and they're in there and then you're just like, oh, here we go. It just sets the scene really well where they're, one's naked, one's like semi-naked, the lights turn on, they got the music in, they start jamming away and then you just see the temperature going up and you're like, here we go.
Yeah. Have either of you done the Choose Your Fate on the DVD extras?
No.
Oh, I think I do remember that vaguely. But so, was that like a mini game choose type thing? Like you got to choose some shit and then you die, you don't die or something?
Yeah, there were so many additional extras where I tried to do them all on my DVD, but honestly, I got a bit bored only because I'd been watching all these other movies throughout the week. So in the first choice, you can actually choose whether they go on the roller coaster or not. If you say no, the movie ends. Like they just all survive. But then,
oh yeah, no, that's right. Okay.
Does it show something after if they don't go in it, like a scene, and then it ends, or does it just abruptly end?
I think
it shows them walking away from the roller coaster, and it just ends, goes to the credits. But it does give you options to like retry certain ones. I can't remember what it was for the drive-through. The gym sequence had an alternative death where instead of being crushed by the weights, he gets crushed by the swords, or like hit by the swords or something.
Which is what you think the whole time is going to happen. It's kind of unexpected when he's like, whoop. Yeah.
Like it gives you like the illusion of choice. Like I know I'm going back to it, but the tanning bed sequence, if you choose to make it 1 degree hotter than what the other girl says, what happens is the plank of wood comes down, but it knocks one of the girls out in the head. So she's on the ground and then the other girl's still like getting fried and shit. But then she pulls her out, and as she's pulling her out, the other girl smashes the tanning bed and they both get electrocuted. And I was like, oh, was that how like it was supposed to be originally? Or did they just like shoehorn the Choose Your Feature in as like a bit of a gimmick?
I reckon they've done a testing screening maybe with the original ones and maybe kind of done it, put a testing screening of those alternative scenes, not excluding the roller coaster one. And then did the tanning scene with another audience and just maybe saw which one worked. But I think the tanning scene as it is, it's good.
Nothing really should be changed.
There's like claustrophobic trying to get out. And then there's just two of them as well. And it's just not happening.
Yeah.
I think there was probably like alternate scenes and then just any of the extra ones that they sort of just used to make a little game out of it, you know?
Mm.
Yeah.
That's cool. Yeah. I didn't know there was any extra scenes from that feature. That's wicked.
They also had this really good DVD feature, which was all about like death is all around us. And like it's mostly from like the first two movies where it's like there are no coincidences, there are no rules, blah, blah, blah. And it was really interesting. Like I always think they should have more of these DVD features, but if they're going to put the movie on something like Netflix or Stan or, I don't know, Hulu in America, like they should add these extras on as well to really have that fully fledged experience.
Like Bandersnatch, have you guys done that?
Yes.
Yeah. That was pretty good. I thought they did a good job.
What is it?
I mean, after fiddling around with it for a few hours, I was like, oh, I think I found all the endings. But Bandersnatch, it's like a Black Mirror thing. It's on Netflix, but you choose how it goes basically when you watch it. It's actually pretty well made, and there's some really crazy shit in there if you do some weird shit and so there's lots of different stuff in there that goes in all different directions depending on what you do. So
just have a little bit of trivia around Final Station 3 as well. So in addition to the plan to use 3D, there was also plans to incorporate the two main characters from Final Station 2 being Kimberly and Officer Burke. So they were the two that survived at the end of the previous movie. They were going to be shown in one sequence at the hardware store actually being chopped up by a wood chipper. So I don't know how that actually would have gone into effect because like that hardware store sequence is made just for the other girl to have the nail gun.
And that night as well. So there wouldn't be any customers in there.
So instead, like that got relegated to an extra on the Final Destination 3 DVD where you can see a newspaper clipping. And like, I thought it was okay, but I also hate when they kill off previous characters just by a DVD extra or by like Polaroid.
Where is number two's body? Is she alive? Is she dead? Who's stealing all these bodies? Don't ask me.
I don't know. It's just not my thing. I did get some little extra tidbits of information from Shalon Simmons. So she's the blonde tanning bed girl. She relayed that they filmed the roller coaster sequence 26 times in order to get all the shots right. But it wasn't 26 times over like a couple of days. It was 26 times in a row. Mm. So they weren't allowed to have any water, any food. They weren't allowed to take bathroom breaks. They just had to get it done 26 times in a row, often taking somewhere between 10 to 15 minutes each for the sequence. And yeah, she actually had no information on the tanning bed itself. She just said that most of it was CGI, but that they would apply some like paint to their skins and stuff. She personally didn't like it, as she has not claustrophobia, but I had this experience too. But she had gone for an MRI, and there were some parts where she felt that it closely related to that, because like there'd be parts where they'd film her like on the ground against like this backdrop. The camera would be like right there in her face. It wasn't the most pleasant filming experience, but it was nothing where she was like in direct harm. There was nothing against health and safety orders. Mm. She wanted to come back for additional installments, but you know, how would they bring her character back?
yeah, exactly.
Be like a flashback movie sequel or something like that. It was all a dream.
Yeah. Yeah. And fun fact, her and the other actress in that teddy bear sequence, they're best friends till this day. So they've worked on other Hallmark movies, that worked together on See No Evil, that stupid one with Kane, the wrestler in it.
I've actually watched that, but I haven't heard good things.
Yeah, it's not that good.
Were they best friends before the movie, or they just met on set, became best friends, and then did she say that? No.
Yeah, they met on set. So
cool.
They were initially a bit of a close-knit group, but like, you know, it's been 16 years since the movie, so... Like, they only talk to each other.
There was a Chanel number 4, but she got meningitis. She was like, I'm sick. I have to go home. And I was like, no, stay. But she went home anyway, and then she died. So another thing I was right about.
But yeah, it was interesting. They were asked to watch some other previous installments. Like, there's I Still Know What You Did Last Summer. There's Urban Legends 3, Bloody Mary, that also have teddy bear sequences. So they, like, watched them to be like, oh, how should I act in this? But they felt that it was just, like, too overacted. Those sequences in particular, I Still Know What You Did Last Summer, nothing actually happens in Urban Legends. The guy does die, but it's a bit stupid. So
the one thing I'll say about the movie, when we were talking about a fear of flying on a plane with this movie, I went to Movie World in October, and every time I went on like the hype, I don't know if you guys have been to Movie World recently. No, yes.
It's been a while. At least
has anyone been on like the hype arrivals, like the new one, the DC arrivals?
I love that one.
Yeah. And then it's like the Superman Escape. But instantly, when you also got the hill, the first thing is you're going over. And I always worry that my restraint, even though it's pushed down, it's tight, I always feel like it's going to open up. So I latch onto it. I'm like, well, it's not going to do anything, because if it opens up, I'm dead. But I always think of Final Destination. I think it comes back to that movie, that you kind of latching on, and you can kind of feel it ever so slightly open up just because it does.
Yeah.
That's that movie. Definitely not the plane, but yeah, the roller coaster thing. When you're on a roller coaster, that's what I think of.
Yeah, 100%. It's something that I find, no matter what happens, each of these movies like carry on my fear or something. Yep. So for me, this like heavily exacerbated my fear of like burning, anything to do with that. But roller coasters, not for me. I'm just a thrill person. Like, I'll go on Superman, I'll be like, woo! Well, like jump off Stratosphere Towers. Or I wanted to do the DC Rivals Coaster one backwards, but couldn't because there was not enough tickets, so I just had to wait.
I'm still bummed that I never got to, because I've been on the Tower of Terror, but I went on it when it went up forwards, and then they changed it backwards. So you go up backwards. But I think I heard sometime over the last year they've gotten rid of the Tower of Terror. It's not there anymore.
Yeah. Yeah, well, there's a page, Gold Coast Theme Parks. That's really interesting. And the giant drop's closing down for 6 months, and they reckon there's going to be a major refurbishment because the track's
still
right at the top. So I don't know if the track's going to get removed completely. Someone had mentioned about the giant drop having possibly tilting seats going in.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
But it's close to 6 months.
Have you guys been on the giant drop?
Yep.
Giant drop, I've been on once, and my stomach is still at the top of that thing.
Hey? Yeah.
I don't know why, but once I was up there, like, I was like, oh, this will be fine. You know, it's just this. Yeah. And then I was up there and I was shitting bricks, and there was a bloody tourist trying to calm me down because I was sitting there swearing in front of her kids. I was like, ah, fuck, shit. And she's like, it's okay. It's like, sorry for swearing. But yeah, it was just, ugh.
Yeah.
Just while you're like sitting there and...
Yeah,
and just because you're looking down at your feet, it doesn't feel like you're on anything. It feels like you're just sitting in air. It's
the whole suspense, because I think you're sitting up there for maybe 40, 45 seconds, and there is a slight before you drop.
Exactly, but yeah.
You're sort of sitting there and you're
like,
you
don't know, though. You just don't know. And and it feels like they're keeping you up there longer than you should be. And you're like, drop, wait, but don't, but do it, please, because I don't want to just be sitting here waiting. Like, yeah.
A friend and I went on it. I think when I went, it would have been maybe... It would have been when the River Rapids was there before. It must have just happened before I went there. And I remember we went on a couple of times because it was a quiet day. And one of the times we just went down because they filmed you all the way down and we just kept a straight face. It was the funniest thing because everything else is flubbering and you're just like, instead of like...
I was always too terrified to go on the giant drop. But when I was in Vegas where instead of going all the way to the top and then dropping, like you sit on it and it goes whoosh. And then it waits for a little bit, then you drop all the way down.
Mm.
And it was nowhere near the same height as a giant drop. It was probably half,
right.
Like, yeah, probably maximum half. And I'd been on all these other runs. So I was like, oh, yeah, I can do this one. This is fine. And got onto it. And when it went up, I was like, oh, that's a little bit scary. But then it paused. And then when it dropped, I lost my shit. I had to pretend that I was okay because I'd made friends with a group of people that were all thrill seekers. Like, oh, wasn't that so cool? And I'm like, yeah. And inside I'm like,
next, forget it.
That DC Rival one, when you go on it, there's a noise at the bottom of the hill and it literally sounds like it's from a saw trap when like it's like time begins now and you hear like a door shutting and it's really like off-putting when you're going up a hill.
I don't want to hear noise.
On a roller coaster because you're just like, is this my time?
Yes. Yeah. Yes, it is.
I want you to stop getting hysterical over nothing. Got it, girl.
So was Final Destination 3 a hit or a miss? While it did initially receive bad reviews, it has been re-evaluated in the past 16 years as possibly the strongest sequel, with creative death scenes and an interesting take on the premonitions motive. So instead of having people have the premonitions, they changed it to have the use of the camera with the Polaroids like we discussed before. Unfortunately, the acclaim stops there for the Final Destination series. In our next episode, we discuss 3D, X-rays, a weak attempt at meta, and more with Final Destination 4, aka The Final Destination. Thank you for tuning in. We hope you enjoyed our analysis and my rant on PTSD, aka post-tanning bed stress disorder. Thank you for tuning in. Bye.